you sick fuck cocksucker. Little itty bitty baby dick dog fucker. We played the back of the damn jam like Gringo. Still you wanna press, try to dance with the dingoes. These the wrong gringos. Step in sinkholes, slipping through the bottom like I'm fucked, well bingo. You see me, hear me clearly thinking like I'm mellow. Give me the fucker mic and prepare to be a yellow. Your spine's yellow. Are you fly? Nah, hell no. Looking like the kind of uses a semen as gel, bro. What type of shit is that? I raise a fucking spliff and take a hit as fat. I take a fucking shit up in your fitted hat. Got anything to say? Well, you can lick this sack, you fuck.
Hard body karate, you bums, coffee and sloppy. You crumbs, body by saucy, so if you spot me, nod, finally can't harm me. Facade, army, important, he's bomb calmly with comedy.
Ever so properly.
You butter soft, better stop talking shit. You better off, never popped off, your bitch. Now take the cock out your esophagus and give props to your pops, two gods who started this. You fucking schoolies can't do me, you and your goonies will lose teeth. Your style is booty and fruity compared to Michael and Moody. You marks ain't doing it truly, don't got the nuts to pursue me. His name might rhyme with it, but y'all the motherfuckers is your duty.
What's up, this is Michael Rapper. We got a brand new
sick fucks,
hard-hitting, smash mouth, I Am Rapaport stereo podcast coming up next. Me and G Moody, live from New York City, are going to do the damn thing. We're talking NBA. We're talking, is Russell Westbrook nuts? We're talking about that piece of shit, Ted Nugent, who is definitely fucking nuts, and so much more. Plus, we have Super Bowl champion of the Philadelphia Eagles, Torrey Smith. He was just traded to the Carolina Panthers. We're not talking about that. He hasn't taken a snap as a Carolina Panther. He hasn't caught a ball from Cam Newton. Talking about his career, we're talking about the outspokenness, and we're talking about what it's like to beat the New England Patriots on the biggest stage, on the biggest game in the entire planet, the Super Bowl. Super Bowl champion Torrey Smith on the I Am Rapaport stereo podcast. Miles Jordan, this is going to be a big banging I Am Rapaport stereo podcast. Plus, we got so many sick fucks. Miles Jordan, let me get something funky. Let me get something real nice. All right, G Moody is downstairs. He's parking the car. The mics are hot. So I'm going to just start rocking and rolling in here. First of all, Geno Auriemma, you fuck you. You fuck you. You lost again. They cut your throat out again. You ain't so bad, Geno. The female Connecticut Huskies, the women's basketball team that Geno Auriemma, that motherfucking coach of Connecticut, blowing teams out. Ha, ha, ha. You got your asses beaten once again at the buzzer. And it was a thing of beauty. Matter of fact, okay, since I wrote the book, this book has balls, the soon-to-be New York Times bestseller. You know, I wrote a chapter in the book, solely focusing on Geno Auriemma, okay? So at the end of this I Am Rapaport stereo podcast, towards the end, Miles, would you please play the audiobook that's available? You know, you could buy my book. This book has both sports rants from the MVP of Talk and Chess. You could buy the hardcover, or you could buy the entire audiobook. It's like 8 hours of shit talking, okay? This chapter, Geno is inspired by the movie Goodfellas. We have special guest, okay? Ron Perlman is in that chapter, okay? He reads one of the voices. I read one of the voices. Paul Ben Victor reads one of the voices, okay? We're going to play you a special excerpt from this book, has bull sports rants from the MVP of Talk and Trash. You could buy the book at Amazon, thisbookhasballs.com. You could buy the book at a bookstore. Just look it up. This book has balls, okay? But Geno, you fuck you. You lost. I want to give a shout out to the Villanova Wildcats for beating the shit out of Michigan. Congratulations. This is their second NCAA championship in, I think, 3 years. And it reminds me, because a few years ago, Villanova ripped the hearts out of North Carolina. And it was crazy because Fife Dog, the late, great Fife Dog from A Tribe Called Quest, was the biggest North Carolina Tar Heel fan in the world. He was all North Carolina, everything. He had a room dedicated to North Carolina in his crib. He called it the Tar Heel Room. He had it at, you know, that the light blue. He loved North Carolina. And I remember, it's crazy, because I remember the night that he passed, I believe he passed on a Sunday. And the finals were on a Monday, of course, because all the NCAA games were on Mondays. North Carolina lost at the buzzer to Villanova. And I remember thinking, if God hadn't met Fife Dog yet, I'm sure you heard him screaming when North Carolina lost at the buzzer to Villanova. I've always been a Villanova fan. Of course, when they beat Georgetown, that was beautiful. Back in the days with Raleigh Massimino and the McLean brothers, who I think were on that that Booger Sugar. I think it came out later on that they were on that Booger Sugar in the Big East. But they beat the shit out of Michigan. This ain't the Fab Five Michigan, the Jalen Rose, Chris Webber Fab Five. So I don't really rock with these dudes. They got their ass beat. I like that Wagner kid on the team, but I had no real stake in it. You know, I didn't. I wasn't emotionally invested, but I go with the old school Big East team. So congratulations to Villanova and Geno, you fuck you, okay? You fuck you. You got your heart ripped out again. Again, this is the Iron Rapaport Stereo Podcast. Coming up very soon, me and G Moody are going to tear the house down, okay? We're going to do what we do. I wanted to address, while I'm waiting for Moody. So, it's been all over the internet. As you know, I'm a tremendous Real Housewives fan. I love it all. Real Housewives of Atlanta, Real Housewives of New York, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, Real Housewives of New Jersey. So, the other day, I was asked to come on Watch What Happens Live with my man, Andy Cohen. And if you don't watch The Real Housewives, there's this chick, this woman named Kenya Moore. She's the bad guy on The Real Housewives of Atlanta. She talks a lot of shit. She antagonizes the shit out of people. And I've actually talked about her on the shows. And to give a quick context, I one time said something about her that I didn't mean to say. One time when I was on live TV with Real Housewives of Atlanta, I basically said something to the effect of, well, the entire cast of The Real Housewives of Atlanta could never be considered beautiful because of Kenya Moore. Kenya Moore is ugly. That's what I was talking about. What I meant to say was Kenya Moore's behavior was ugly. Anyway, so that night, this is about 2 or 3 years ago, we had a little exchange on Twitter. She said some bullshit. I said some bullshit. But I felt bad. So going into my appearance on Watch What Happens Live the other night with Andy Cohen, I knew that this had happened. But, you know, I'm a guest on the show. She's a woman. I'm never going to be disrespectful to a woman. And I felt bad that I had said that because it's not what I meant to say. It's live TV. Sometimes things just happen. You're talking. I'm talking shit. And I said this. So I wanted to diffuse it. I wanted to, you know, I had never met her. I am a fan of the show. I'm not part of the motherfucking show. I'm just a fan. And so when I got to Watch What Happens Live, I went backstage. I was in my dressing room, and I went over to Kenya Moore into her dressing room. She was in there with, you know, her glam squad. They were putting on her hair and her makeup, and they were really dolling her up like she was going to the fucking Oscars with the makeup. And, you know, they had the blower. The makeup was, you know, it was being, like, it wasn't just being put on. It was, like, being blown on. Like, they got the machine. They're, like, they're taking up big spaces at a time to cover her up. Anyway, I went in there. I said, how you doing, Kenya? I'm Michael. Wanted to meet you. You know, I'm a fan of the show. And I wanted to apologize because of what I said. I didn't mean to say that. I didn't mean what I said. I felt bad about it. And I wanted to acknowledge that I felt bad. And blah, 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 blah. She wouldn't make eye contact with me. And then she said, okay, well, thank you. And I said, all right, cool. I just wanted to let you know that I didn't mean it. I'm excited to do the show with you. And, you know, it's all good. But I had a feeling. I was like, yo, this fucking broad, she's going to come out here talking shit. She's going to come out here talking shit. And again, it's a female. I like to talk shit, but I'm not a fucking real housewife. I'm a fan. I'm just a fan. And there's no winning with me being the Gringo Mandingo, the shit-talking extraordinaire that I am, the MVP of talking trash. You know, it's a lose-lose situation for me to go out on Watch What Happens Live and insult her. So we started doing the show. And, you know, she wouldn't make eye contact with me. We're doing the show. I'm trying to be pleasant. I'm trying to be friendly, trying to be nice. And she start, you know, popping shit. I was kind of attacking, but she started popping shit. And at the midway point of the show, this is the exchange. Miles Jordan, play this little exchange.
Do you know that you are on the show, like, a villain, right? You know, you have to know this, correct? You've gotten better.
Well,
but you are a villain.
Michael, I don't need you to tell me what I am or am not.
On the show.
I appreciate you being a fan, though.
Thank you
for watching. Keep the cable on.
But...
A new job would help with that.
Oh, Kenya, please, Kenya, you wish you were me, Kenya.
A middle-aged fat white guy. No. Not really.
Kenya.
No, and out of work.
How do I...
No.
And you work. Look me up. No, you're talking about fat.
She said out of work.
Kenya, a lot of women housewives, they talk about glam squads. You
Michael.
Have like a whole football team back there.
Yeah,
they had the blow torches, the buzz sores, and everything just to get you out here.
All right. You do know that housewives are women, right?
Yes, I do.
We're not giving out any peaches. Okay.
All right.
So she calls me a middle-aged fat white guy. Now, we all know, and she said that I don't work and I can't pay my cable, and I'm like, a bitch, please. You know, look me up. Look up my stats. But I didn't say anything. You know, my wife was pissed. I saw Twitter immediately respond because they were like, if you had said a middle-aged, fat, black woman, like, literally, I would have been in trouble. But I didn't say anything because I knew it was, like, kind of a lose-lose situation. So I just took it. You know, and that's part of talking shit. You know, I'm the first to say it. When you're snapping, and that's essentially what we're doing, when you're snapping, whether or not what she's saying is real or genuine or not, when we're snapping, that's part of, you know, you got to take it. She's a woman trying to be like a good guest on the show. And then she said a couple of other little jabs. And I was like, this fucking broad, man, she doesn't know who the fuck she's sitting next to. Because I don't play that shit. So we finished the show. And the whole time while we're doing Watch What Happens Live, I'm looking down at her big ass feet. Okay? I just happened to notice she got some big ass feet. And then God is my witness, I happened to notice very early that she got some big ass ashy fucking feet. I'm talking about like the glam squad hit her up top to bottom, but they didn't hit the bottom of her feet. Her feet were the color of motherfucking oatmeal. Okay? Straight up. Like her joints were like sand color. Ashy as a motherfucker. And I didn't say anything the whole show because I was like, you know, I knew like it would be very provocative. So, you know, towards the end of the show, I was like, I was going to say, because she was talking out the side of her fucking mouth, and I figured I could, you know, I could just hit her with the 1-2 punch and shut the shit down. The show ends, and then right after Watch What Happens Live, because I'm sure a lot of you people don't listen to Watch What Happens Live, but I'm sure there are fans of Watch What Happens Live listening to this podcast, because, you know, I'm addressing the situation. So right after the live broadcast on Bravo, they go on to Watch What Happens Later. It's the live broadcast where you can curse, you could say whatever you want, blah, 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 blah. And it goes online. It goes on the Bravo app and it goes on YouTube. So I had to hit her. Like she's talking out the side of her mouth. I had to hit her. So I said to her on the live show, I said this, Miles, play the clip.
So please don't come for me, honey, because I did not send for you. Now, what's your question?
I didn't say anything. You know what? I didn't want to say it on live TV, but Kenny's feet are ashy as fuck. Them shits are ashy.
You know what?
I didn't want to say it on live TV because I'm a gentleman, but paying down to them shits, she can cut glass with them shits.
Yes, honey, try it. He tried it.
Yes, them
he
shits are ashy.
He doesn't have anything else. Clearly, his comedy days are over.
I never was a comedian.
You never were.
I never was. I'm just a funny motherfucker.
And I talked about her motherfucking ashy ass feet. And blah, blah, and she didn't know what to do. And you know, meanwhile, during the show, she's like, don't point at me, you know, and she got her foot all in my, I'm like, whatever, I could take all that shit, we could talk shit, whatever, this is not a fight, like, it's a show. I'm there to make a good show. It's you know, Watch What Happens Live, the TV show, you know, so, like I said, you know, you got to be able to take it as good as you could give it. That's why I am the Jake LaMotta of podcasting. Nonetheless, Twitter was all hyped up. Ooh, that was a good Watch What Happens Live. I talked my little shit. She's like, I read you. I was like, oh, cool. I tried to shake her hand, and she still really wouldn't make eye contact. I'm like, fuck it. I'm out of here. So I go home. It's late at night. Now it's like probably like 12 o'clock at night. I get home, shower, blah, 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 blah. I got to catch a 6 a.m. flight back to Los Angeles. Got to get up at 4 a.m. I couldn't fall asleep. About two and a half hours later, and anybody who follows my page, anybody who follows my Instagram, my social media, knows if you follow my Instagram, probably once a day or once every other day, especially on my Instagram stories, I post pictures of monkeys, gorillas, or orangutans. I love monkeys, gorillas, or orangutans. I love them. I consider myself a monkey, gorilla, or an orangutan. Like that albino gorilla that passed away, like that's my spirit animal. I love gorillas, okay? So about 2.5 hours later, I saw this artist. He won some contest. He made a sculpture of Andre the Giant, I guess for the Andre the Giant documentary that's come out. And I was like, oh shit. So I go to his page and I see this dope sculpture of Andre the Giant. I'm scrolling through his page. I'm like, yo, this is dope. He did a dope sculpture of a gorilla, like some angry gorilla. So I post a picture of the gorilla and then I post a picture of Andre the Giant. I don't say anything. I didn't realize that the last post that I had made on my Instagram stories was of me on Watch What Happens Live with Kenya Moore. So the next morning, I wake up and all these motherfuckers like, why are you posting a picture of Kenya Moore and then posting a picture of a gorilla? And I'm like, oh, fuck. I knew exactly where this shit was going. I'm not going to explain this shit to everybody on Instagram because I'm like, yo, I always post pictures of gorillas. I actually wanted to post the Andre the Giant sculpture first, but I just happened to post the gorilla picture first. And people are like, you're calling Kenya Moore a gorilla. That's basically what social media is saying the next morning. You're calling Kenya Moore a gorilla. Like, that was what I was insinuating. I'm like, these motherfuckers are out of their fucking minds. So I don't really respond. Next thing you know, I see like these bullshit blogs. You know, I see stuff on Twitter. My wife's like, yo, I'm like, I see it. I know. And she's like, I know you didn't mean it. I go, I know I didn't fucking mean it. I post gorillas all the time. I follow Docantile, D-O-C-A-N-T-L-E, Baba Booey. I always post monkeys and gorillas. I've considered myself a monkey and gorilla. It was no, like, just because it's Instagram story doesn't mean I'm telling a fucking story. It's just random posts. I post all this shit up there. Anyway, this whole thing is escalating into, you're calling Kenya Moore a gorilla. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? So it comes down to, a few hours later into the day, The Root, that bullshit rag, that bum-ass, fake-ass media outlet that veils itself as some sort of black, pro-black, you know, media outlet, and it's all things black, and it's all things black culture, and I'm sure they post a lot of things. But this is the third or fourth time these motherfuckers have come at me and started popping shit. Literally, I don't know if it's the fourth time or the third time. These motherfuckers are on a motherfucking America's Next Top Racist witch hunt trying to come at me, and they talk crazy in there. They talk crazy. They're insulting me, insulting my career, insulting my life, talking about my black wife, all kind of bullshit. And I'm like, fuck, I've Willie Hutched them before. Okay? I've Willie Hutched these motherfuckers before. It's a bum-ass website. They've blocked me on Twitter. Okay? So all this shit just happens just because of some Instagram shit. I'm posting something and people are like, you're trying to say Kenya Moore. I'm like, I'm just trying to say shit. Motherfucker, nobody's, and they're like, we caught you. You said this, you said that. I'm like, all right. So this motherfucker, some bullshit, bum-ass writer for The Root, writes an entire blog on the grapevine, .The Root, a writer named Michael Harriott, H-A-R-R-I-O-T. This motherfucker writes an entire blog, and blogs are literally like assholes. Anyone can write one, okay? He writes an entire blog and it's titled, Michael Rapaport is the Worst Kind of White Man. This is what he writes. Now, a lot of people on Twitter are like, Kenya Moore talk shit to you. You talk shit to Kenya Moore. You know, why'd you say she's ashy? What kind of white man, you know, you got no right saying that to a black woman? And I'm like this, check this out. Check this out, Duke. Where I come from, it's called snapping. Okay, where I come from, it's called snap. But there's no fucking rules. Kenya Moore wasn't offended that I said she was ashy. She was mad that I said her big motherfucking Fred Flintstone Barney Rubble feet were the same color of dusty, dry, stale oatmeal. But she didn't take it personal. She wasn't like, this is a racial assault. But Twitter, Instagram, these motherfuckers said that. And the fact that I post a picture of a gorilla 2 hours later, all of a sudden this becomes a race issue. Anyway, you know where this is heading. Miles, Jordan, let me get that Willie Hutch. This motherfucker, Michael Harriet, the root, the grapevine. You about to get that good old Willie Hutch treatment. You motherfuckers have been listening too much Frank Ocean. All right? You hear that, Willie Hutch? Stop listening to that Frank Ocean. Get your mind right. Get your soul right. You corny motherfuckers. All of you. All of you motherfuckers at the root. Always trying to bring the motherfucking man down. Me being the man. You wrote an entire motherfucking article saying Michael Rapaport is the worst kind of white person. Are you a white person specialist? Motherfucker, you study white people? Is that your motherfucking skill set? Are you a professor of white folk in general? Trying to talk shit to me? The Gringo Mandingo? White Mike? AKA Bird? That place, the root, doesn't like it. They keep trying to come at me. They keep trying to pop shit to me, White Mike. And I'm trying to tell you people at the root, all of you, the whole staff, the ladies that have talked shit, the guys that have talked shit there, I suck this dick. Okay? They don't like that. I keep saying, I suck this dick. They don't like that. I don't backpedal to their bullshit. Jake LaMotta never backpedaled. You think I'm backpedaling? You think the Jake LaMotta of podcasting is backpedaling to some bum-ass writers that aren't even writers from some bum-ass website at the root? It ain't happening. I go 15 hard rounds. I'm not complying with you corny motherfuckers. You could write every single blog you want. Try to defame the name and the game. You hear that, Willie Hutch? I don't backpedal. I come at your chest, rough, rugged, and raw. I run the yard up in here, Duke. I run the motherfucking yard. Shout out to my man, Darts Golden. You bum-ass non-writing writers, you can't touch this, to quote the great MC Hammer. Yes, you can't touch this, to quote the great MC Hammer once again. You hear the motherfucking Willie Hutch, Michael Harriet, The Root, all your writers. Fuck you. Fuck you as a staff, as a record label, and as a bum-ass media outlet. I'm coming in here rough, rugged, and raw, solo on that ass. And it's still the same, like motherfucking Snoop Dogg. You bum-ass non-writing writers. I know you writers at the root ain't really writers. I know y'all got second and third jobs, and that's cool. No disrespect to second and or third jobs. But don't front like the root is a real company and you're an actual paid writer. Where's your health insurance from, Duke? Is it from the Writers Guild of America? That's the goal. If you're a real writer, is your health insurance from the Writers Guild of America? It ain't, motherfucker. Because you ain't a professional writer. You're a writer like the motherfucker at the red light is a car washer who comes up and starts washing your windows at the red light. That's the kind of writer you are. This is something you just do. You ain't getting paid for it. You're getting coins, motherfucker. You know how when you get stopped at a red light and the motherfucker sprays dirty-ass water on your car and starts washing your window down with newspaper? That's the kind of motherfucking writer you are, Michael Harriet, and the whole crew at the root. You get paid in motherfucking coins and out of resentment. Motherfuckers don't want to pay you. You ain't WGA, Duke. Your insurance ain't WGA, Duke. You ain't a pro writer, Duke. This is a hobby. This is a dream, you bum ass, you. You bullshit, racial scavenger hunting ass motherfucker. That is that Willie Hutch. You hear that good old love. You're always talking bullshit. Every single time you write one of your bullshit blogs about me, about my relevancy. You know who I am. You know about my relevancy. You know my motherfucking pedigree. You Joe Blow in and out of the closet motherfuckers. You watched my films before you came to terms with your own sexuality. That's a fact. You was up in the movie theater holding hands with motherfuckers before you understood your own sexuality. And you talk about my relevancy? You grew up on my dick. You still on my dick. You know me. You know my work. You love my style. You've been on my dick, to quote the great Nas Escobar. All you motherfuckers at the Root, you're fans. Send me something to sign. I'll sign it. Sign it for you, your wife, your husband, or whatever the fuck else you got, you freaky motherfuckers. You hear that, Willie Hutch? Start listening to some of that good soul music. Get your motherfucking mind right, you freaks. Yeah, you a freak. You a freak. Get off my dick. All right? Michael Rapaport is the worst kind of white man. Nah, motherfucker. Michael Rapaport ain't compliant to your bullshit. I'm not, oh, I'm so, fuck you. Michael Harriet, fuck the Root. And fuck everybody that has to do with that bullshit website. That shit is straight a fugazi. Miles, Jordan, let me hear something funky. I'm gonna get started with G Moody, whose last name rhymes with Duty. Test, 1, 2, 1, 2, up two. Okay, okay, okay. This is the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast coming live and direct from the city of New York. My name is Michael Rapaport. Here with the three-time podcast co-host of the year, G Moody, whose last name rhymes with Duty.
Yeah.
We're here. We're doing it. It's the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. Have no fear. The I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast is here. It's our time of year. It is our time of year. The NBA playoffs, they're right in front of us.
Yes.
It's happening. I know you had a lot to say a few days ago about the Oklahoma City Thunder.
Yeah.
Their star player, Russell Westbrook, obviously one of the greatest players in the NBA right now.
Yeah.
A future Hall of Famer.
You think so? Go ahead, go ahead.
What do you mean? Russell Westbrook's making it into the Hall of Fame,
okay,
no doubt.
Okay. The shit lowered now. The standards have lowered. Grant Hill went in, and I don't think he's a Hall of Famer.
As much as I love Grant Hill,
yep,
and as much as his career was injured, I have to say I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
And I respect the shit out of Grant
Hill.
Me too. And he obviously, had he not suffered from so many injuries,
he would have been a lock.
But suffered from a lot. Listen, we're going to get to a point now where guys, questionable guys are going to get in. There's always going to be the stars. There's always going to be, right, you know, the elite of the elite. But there's going to be, like, every year they need to put a certain amount of people in, and there's going to be, like, question marks on dudes.
I don't think he is Hall of Fame worthy in comparison to some of the other guys that didn't make the cut. Bernard King. He's not Hall of Fame?
Yeah, Bernard should be in. I mean, he had injuries, but when he was rocking and rolling,
World Be Free, a lot of guys, man. World Be Free's
not in the Hall of Fame,
no,
right? No. Motherfuckers, no. They need to put World Be Free in the Hall of Fame.
If you're going
to
revise, go back. Leave these fucking new guys. Let them wait if you are on the cusp.
Obviously, Russell Westbrook is a Hall of Famer. These guys laughing. Russell Westbrook, you...
Listen... That's remains to be seen.
Yo, he's already, if he doesn't play another game at the airing of this podcast, what he's accomplished in his career, he's already Hall of Fame.
Okay, I'll give you that. All right.
Okay? So I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Now, we can talk about whether or not he's ever going to win an NBA championship, and I don't think the way things are going in Oklahoma City,
yeah,
and the way, the style that he plays, he's going to win an NBA championship.
Right. I saw something the other night that was deplorable.
What did you see?
At the end of the game against the San Antonio Spurs.
Right.
He basically spazzed out. Meaning, yo, he took ill-advised shots. He didn't give a fuck about the teammates. Even Carmelo was on the other side with his hands in the air, perplexed. Like, even I'm not as bad as that.
Right, you, like, I thought I was bad, but this guy's fucking nuts.
And he did it four times in a row. He shot two air balls, and he turned it over twice with no remorse, with no regard.
What do you mean, remorse? What do you mean, remorse?
Like, as a player, on any level, if you make, if you take an ill-advised shot when a player is open, you feel that guilt, and you want to get it back to the next player. My bad, my fault. This guy had no regard. He didn't give a fuck of what he did, what the outcome was. It was air balls, and I said, they're scared of him.
Who?
The coaching staff. Because in any level, you do shit like that, you're going to hear the buzzer. Time out. What the fuck are you doing? They're more than capable players over here. You have Carmelo, an all-timer. Paul George, and you just disregard these guys like they ain't shit. Come sit on the bench. That's how you teach them. But they're scared of him, Rap, because they know he will get into the game after you do that, and then he won't shoot.
Right.
Psychopath. They know that. So they try to, they deal with him on eggshells. They walk on eggshells around this guy. Fuck that. Sit down over here. It's my team. Donovan is scared of him.
Billy Donovan, get control of your team.
Yeah, man.
This is not what you were groomed by the great Rick Pitino. We could say what we want to say
he's
about
a great
Rick,
coach.
Great coach. Rick Pitino had you on a fucking tight leash when you were at Providence.
Right. Could you do something like that?
No.
Yo, so you're doing a disservice to the game.
He's potentially ending Carmelo's career, although his skill set. Carmelo Anthony will be playing for a long time because of the type of offensive skill set that he has. But he's a non-factor this year.
Get out of there.
Paul George has been forced to focus on defense because of this.
They're all leaving. They got one-year deals, I think. They're not resigning. They know what time it is. I'm sure they have discussions among themselves. Because when we were playing, you know, when a guy's chucking and not giving a fuck, the team always saying, yo, they don't clap for this fucking guy. I'm telling you, man. Get this fuck, leave Carmelo before your shit is over.
Oh, dude. Yeah, Carmelo's got to go. Paul George is definitely not coming back. I guaranteed Paul George is absolutely positively not coming back. And I can't see why any big free agent
would go
there just because Russell, as great as he is, he just, like, you know, sometimes, like, you'll hear these guys, I can't remember who it was either Isaiah Thomas or Charles Barkley. They were like, well, everybody else needs to learn how to play with Russell Westbrook.
Right.
I don't think it's possible.
A point guard's supposed to get everybody involved.
No, he's not doing that.
He's like the fucking David Berkowitz over there. What the fuck,
man? I think that he's still into his stats. Even though last year he broke that record with the triple-double, I think that he's still into his stats. And I don't understand it.
10 years in.
I don't get it. And I fucking love Russell Westbrook, but they're not winning. Now, they can give Golden State... or they can give Houston a challenge, but you're not—they're not winning.
Winning with that.
There's no way they're winning.
You see,
it's just not happening because as of right now, and there's a couple of games left. As of right now, Oklahoma is playing Portland in the first round. Portland could beat Oklahoma.
Oh,
now
yeah.
Oklahoma could beat Portland
if his head is on right. But history tells me he's gonna wild out more in the playoffs. Like, yo, they brought these two all-stars here. Like, I need them. Fuck them. It's about me.
Yeah, he's really like, fuck them. It's about me.
Yep.
I don't know. I mean, right now, they're talking about James Harden's the MVP of the NBA.
LeBron is the fucking MVP.
I agree. I totally agree. LeBron James is the MVP of the NBA last year, this year. First of all, the fact that he's playing, unless something happens, all 82 games.
Yeah, in his 15th year.
And the fact that he's statistically, he's had some of his best statistics. We don't stat check here at the I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast, nor do we fact check. The fact that he's still doing this, I mean, the reality of it is the Rockets would still be okay without Harden. The Cleveland Cavaliers would be at the bottom of the Eastern Conference without LeBron James. So when you talk about most valuable, the most valuable player in the league to a specific team, as much as I can't stand LeBron, and it's very well documented, he's the MVP
absolutely
of the NBA.
It's clear.
They're never going to give it to him again. He'll never win that award again because they're like, oh, we got to give it to James. We got to give it to, it's LeBron James.
Yeah, man. Everybody who plays ball knows that, man. This guy, he couldn't be without, that team couldn't be without him.
And they're going to go to the finals, right, barring injuries to LeBron James. Toronto ain't ready. They beat their ass a couple of days ago like it was nothing, yeah, just to let them know, like, yo, y'all ain't ready. You might have the coach of the year. All these regular season awards, they don't mean anything.
Yeah.
They really don't mean anything. So much is going on. So, Gerald, you couldn't be there for my last Willie Hutch when I Willie Hutched Laura Ingraham.
Yeah, I heard. You didn't get kicked off?
It was beautiful. I did not get kicked off Twitter because my post, I was going to post it on Twitter, and then I said, nah, if I do that, these commies. Yeah. See, they call the left commies. They call the Democrats commies. I call these fucking animals commies. I didn't post it, but I want to give a shout out to all the Fox News supporters, Laura Ingraham, all the Trump supporters that posted my video. Thank you for making me go viral once again.
Wow.
I appreciate it. And I got challenged to 4 fights last week.
I read one.
Boxing matches, fights, charity fights. Everybody wants to fucking dance with the
Dingo. Everybody wants a piece of you.
Everybody wants a piece of me. Because you know why? Because when Michael Rapaport talks shit, people listen. Shout out to E.F. Hutton.
Word, yeah.
Shout out to E.F. Hutton. Those are commercials. If you're of a certain age, you know, remember those commercials. When E.F. Hutton talks, people listen. Right. But I wanted to thank all the people for posting my video for me and making me go viral, but not getting me suspended off of Twitter. Because you know they would have suspended me off of Twitter.
Right.
Laura Ingraham, after, just 24 hours after I gave her the Willie Hutch treatment,
uh-huh,
on this here I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast. Call it a coincidence? I don't think so. She went on vacation.
Oh, yeah.
She took a little sabbatical. She went on vacation.
Yeah, the heat was too much.
But the crazy thing about it is the social media blast towards me. The fact that this crazy broad, Laura Ingraham, has supporters, the fact that people, like, stand by this type of shit is wild to me.
Oh.
Yo, I mean, tons of people, and I didn't even post the video. Facebook, I didn't post it on there. You know, they'll shut you the fuck down.
Right.
They're high and mighty bullshit. They're letting elections be being swayed, but I can't post my little shit talk video. People, you motherfucker, stand with Laura. How can you call her a pig face? You're a pig face. People want to fight. People want this. People want that. Yo, this is the same woman that was like, that shut up and dribble shit?
Yeah.
That's like telling a garbage man, shut up and deliver the garbage.
Right.
That's basically like, yo, what you say means nothing.
Right.
Of any race, creed, like, who the fuck are you to say that about somebody? Shut up and dribble.
Right.
Or shut up and be a garbage. Shut up and be a janitor.
Yeah, you should expect some blowback from that, telling people that.
You're talking that crazy shit. And then whether or not these Parkland shooting survivors they're 17. Imagine we're in Erasmus Hall High School.
Right.
Imagine when we were kids, we're in Erasmus Hall High School, and there's a shooting.
Right.
Running around through the hallways of Erasmus Hall High School, shooting people, mowing down teachers, and you come out of that shit. Imagine that's a life-changing thing, and you sit there and you witness your friends, people in your class, your teachers getting fucking shot and killed in front of you. And these kids, the reason why they're speaking out is because they grew up witnessing this from their entire life. They heard about Columbine. They heard about what happened in that preschool.
It was common.
It's like a regular thing. So now they're like, yo, we're going to say something about it. And some of the things they're saying might be spot on. Some of the things might not be spot on. But the fact that, again, that these kids are having to speak out, the fact that they're having to march, that they're having walkouts, this shit ain't for publicity.
Yeah. And that's when she made it seem.
These kids are being crucified by this fucking lunatic, Ted Nugent, this fucking crazy motherfucker who threatened
the guns.
The guns.
Yeah, it's about the guns, man. And they feel
nobody's
threatened.
Taking your guns.
I thought Obama was taking them.
These guys are like so hyped up about the guns. Nobody's taking your guns. Like, what is this catastrophe you're waiting for? Like, I just don't get it. This fucking Constitution was written hundreds of years ago.
It's a living, breathing document. That's what they call it. So it's a living, breathing document. It's like...
I just updated my phone.
Oh, you still with Apple?
No, I'm saying I like everything gets updated except for this Constitution. This is the perfect document, like written hundreds of years ago. But we update our phones. We get new sneaker styles. We go from baggy jeans to skinny jeans. The materials change. The materials get better.
Right.
Buildings get knocked down and remade. Everything gets changed. Snapple is now serving their Snapple drinks in plastic bottles for whatever reason. Things change. Things evolve, but not the fucking Constitution. And these Ted Nugent motherfuckers and this bitch, Laura Ingraham, they're going after these kids. Imagine going after survivors of 9/11.
What are they saying? Wait,
they're saying all kind of shit. He said they're soulless kids.
Oh, what?
They're soulless, mushy brain kids. Imagine attacking firemen that escaped 9/11. Imagine attacking, workers that were there for the Oklahoma City bombing. Imagine attacking, anybody that was, like, under some sort of duress, under a terrorist attack. Imagine that.
Yeah.
But for some reason, these motherfuckers are going after teenagers.
I don't understand.
Who are just traumatized.
Right.
And who've been put in the spotlight and who haven't shied away from the spotlight and have inspired other kids to do something that they shouldn't be doing. And these motherfucking savages are attacking them.
Yeah, I don't get the motive. I don't.
Yo, I don't want to go into a whole Trump shit. It's this divisiveness. The most reprehensible thing that Dick Stained Donald Trump and the most historical thing that he's done and that will carry over when he leaves is the divisiveness, man. That's the thing that's going to be that he broke. That is going to be the hardest thing to fix. Motherfuckers are on some civil war shit in this country. The mentality. It's fucking crazy.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Fuck all the money. Fuck all the taxes and all that shit. Yo, there's an undercurrent in this country. It's real. And it shouldn't be that way. We live in America. It's a great fucking country.
I always said it. It's a great place.
I just don't understand. Could you imagine, like, people going after firemen or policemen or EMT people that were down there at 9/11 and they're saying, and they're speaking out about it? It would never happen. But you're in a high school shooting, you're saying something about it, and you're trying to figure out what you just saw and how to try to avoid any other people having to deal with this. And motherfuckers are talking about their guns, and these kids ain't shit. Damn. You ain't shit.
Damn, that's what they do.
That's what they're doing.
Going at the kids. Because the kids are making a statement about the guns, and they feel threatened, like, yo, they're going to take our
Nobody's
guns.
Taking your fucking, your hunting rifles and your fucking Barracuda AK-99,
right.
Whatever the fuck. Get the fuck out of here with that shit. Shit is ridiculous, man. The Roseanne show, Roseanne Barr.
They're rebooting everything.
Rebooting everything. But Roseanne, 18.5 million people. She came and stirred it up.
That's what's up. She's a Trump supporter in real life.
Trump supporter in real life, very political. Roseanne's opinions on politics, I respect them because she's
out front with it, always been.
And she's also very informed. I don't agree with some of the shit she says, but she's informed.
Right, right. And, yo, it's two sides of the coin. You got people who love Donald Trump. You got people who on the right. And, they should be heard as well. You know what I'm saying?
So, I agree.
So you got to, it's good, but... If you're going to reboot all that, I want all my shows back, too.
You mean, do you want to reboot? What else? What do you want back?
I want Happy Days.
Yo, bring back Happy Days. The whole cast is, they have enough of the cast that is alive. Bring back old-ass Fonzie.
Sanford and Son.
Well, we can't. Red Fox is...
Just shows.
Oh, just get a new guy to play Red Sanford.
Yeah, hell yeah.
But Happy Days would be hype. Like, you could have Richie Cunningham. Mm-hmm. Ron Howard is alive. The great Henry Winkler is alive. Ralph Mouthing them.
Right. As old cats. If you're going to do that, bring back the classic joints, man. I'm with it.
Red, what else would you like to see brought back?
What's happening?
Yup. Those guys are alive.
They're still alive. Let's do it. Good times. The motherfucker's still alive.
Is everybody alive?
Yeah. They're not in the projects no more.
Right. JJ started an upstart business and they made it.
Yo.
That would be good. Bring back the fucking Brady Bunch.
Yeah, if you're going
to old ass Brady Bunch.
Because obviously you got no creativity.
No. No.
So just cave in and do everything.
What else should they bring back?
Shit, what else, rap? We like, welcome back, Cotter.
Oh, still man, a couple of them passed. Yeah. But they, yo, you got Barbarino.
You can fill in.
You can fill in. And welcome back, Cotter would be dope.
Yeah.
Yo, they should, Laverne and Shirley.
Absolutely.
Yeah, fuck it. Just bring back the whole Thursday night. Suzanne Summers and, well, John Ritter passed. It's hard to do three. Just reboot it.
Yep. Yeah, and they're probably going to do it based on the success of that. Because it's a copycat league, right?
Oh, they're going to bring back more.
Yeah.
They're gonna definitely bring back more because Will and Grace is a hit. Roseanne is a hit.
Yeah.
Trust me. The Friends people are they've
they amped
had,
up.
I guarantee you they've had discussions about it. I guarantee fucking to you they've had discussions about bringing back Friends. Whether or not they do it, they are like, yo, should we do this shit? Maybe Seinfeld might come back. You know that would kill.
Yeah.
They're like, yo, let's do it for two seasons. We get $1 million each.
Right.
Knock the shit out.
Yeah, because the other shit is whack that you put out. Bring back the shit that's guaranteed to get viewership.
I guarantee you those shows have had discussions. Those big shows have had discussions.
That's what's up.
Who knows? Did you watch the first episode of Roseanne?
I saw excerpts of it.
Yeah, I mean, yo, I mean, it's the same show. And it makes sense that her characters, and she'll probably go back and forth. Like, the hoopla that show after one episode caused, they're going to flip-flop, change things around. Maybe one week she loves Trump, next week she doesn't love Trump. And it's perfect that it's Roseanne's. I've always liked Roseanne.
Yeah.
Do you remember when I used to do comedy, we used to hang out at the Improv, seeing Roseanne there?
Yep, I remember seeing her.
She was one of the few people that always like, you're funny. She was always cool with me. So I fuck with Roseanne. I fuck with Tom Arnold. Where the tapes at?
Where the tapes at, Duke?
Where the tapes at, Duke? What else is going on? I can tell you what else is really going on. The Butter Soft I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast t-shirts are really going on. All Butter Soft I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast t-shirts are available. We have the King of New York, the Oakley t-shirt. Of course, we have the Disruptive Behavior Buttersoft t-shirt, the Suck a Shit t-shirt. All I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast t-shirts are available. Some are available for discount prices at districtlines.com/IAmRapaport. That's districtlines.com/IAmRapaport. And they're always buttersoft. You know, people have tried to bite the moniker, the Buttersoft Monica. People are still biting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
People are still biting. Trust me, motherfuckers are going to try to bite and then re-bite and then bite again the LeBron blames because we're getting into the playoffs. Yeah. LeBron blames comes alive during the playoffs. But you could bite it. You could bite it all you want. We're just going to keep on shucking, jiving, moving, sticking, dodging, and all that shit.
And everybody know where you bit it from. So what's the point in biting? Everybody know you got it from us.
You got it from us. LeBron blames.
Right.
We invented it.
Right. Not like you're sneaking around.
No. Not like you're fucking sneaking around. I want to give a shout out. Yo, you know this is the Iron Rapaport Stereo Podcast. We don't fact check. And I don't have my phone nor my computer in front of me. But there's one dude, and he knows who he is. I'm in communication. There is one dude who is the sick fuck of the week beast.
Oh, word?
He DMs me. So many sick fucks of the week. Uh-huh. And I can't remember what your name is. He knows who he is. And I'm always, I told him, I said, yo, like, he's kind of like the sick fuck of the week champion. Like, he's sending me sick, like, when I feel like I have all the sick fuck of the weeks zeroed in on, he'll send me some next level shit.
Wow.
And on this I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast coming up later, we have some really sick fucks of the week. I mean, they're just lining up. What else is going on, Mr. Moody?
Oh, man. I just want to tell you, man, I want to shout these guys out that came all the way from London, England, and brought gifts. You know, they're fans of the show. Amy and my man Ben from London, England. Okay. Just want to say thanks for the gifts.
What'd they hook you up with?
They hit Emirates, you know, the soccer team.
Yeah.
Got my name on the back.
Did I get a fucking jersey from?
Nah, man. They didn't look out for you.
That's fucked up. They got you a fucking jersey.
Some good chocolates.
Okay. But I didn't get a jersey.
I didn't hear too much from them about that. But they were cool folks.
Okay.
So we just want to shout them out.
Absolutely, absolutely. Going back one more time to the nightmare. The fucking nightmare that happened at the Parkland school.
Uh-huh.
And this seems to happen all the time. The kid, who I'm not going to say his name, is being flooded with fan mail. The shooter.
Oh, what?
The murderer. Man. The killer. The savage. The animal.
Why?
Because people are sick. You know what? That's crazy. An impromptu sick fuck of the week. Miles Jordan. Cue the sick fuck of the week music.
This award is earned, not given.
Okay,
it's called
now shut it. Okay. The people that are sending fan mail and support for the Parkland school shooter, you are true blue sick fucks of the week.
Yeah.
You think this is cool? You think this is some sort of victim? You're supporting this piece of shit? Women are like, they want to marry him. Men, like, all ages, all different kind. Like, I mean, this happens. People are nuts. Like, Charles Manson, he used to get, like, fan mail.
Yeah, yeah. But damn, they think it was, like, some politically driven thing where he killed motherfuckers for gun rights.
And some people have fallen in love with him.
Yo,
that's He's good. Hot. You know, like, the Menendez brothers used to get it.
Yeah.
You know, the night shooter. The night killer in L.A., I remember he used to... This is nuts, though.
Damn. Damn. They don't...
You know, this whole thing with the Laura Ingraham and the Ted Nugent and me, 17 people. 17 people were murdered.
And that's lost.
Instantaneously. Yeah. You know, this Vegas thing... I mean, these are people that are murdered and, like, this becomes politicized about the gun shit.
They feel he's like a martyr.
This is not a martyr. This is a sick fuck.
This is an
and
animal.
People that are sending him support and fan mail, you're also sick fucks.
Of course.
Miles Jordan, let me get some funk just to give me a breather here.
Word.
All right, we're back. That's Moody Beats.
Yeah.
All these beats that you listen to are crafted by G Moody. I want to give a shout out to the dudes that were rhyming.
Oh, yeah. Spits and Giggles. Classic shit, man. That's hot shit. Salute y'all, dudes.
Fuck with you. And the other cat was rhyming over the Wu-Tang. Anybody who wants to rhyme over Moody Beats,
go get them.
Where the Moody Beats at?
Moody Beats at SoundCloud. Go get that funk, man. That boom bap and get on that.
Speaking of boom bap, I don't know when we're going to drop it. Okay, it's going to come very shortly. Might be the next episode. Might not be the next episode. Okay. But it is an I Am Rapaport stereo podcast, but it's going to feel more like a documentary. I got to sit down with Primo, Gangstar producer.
Hall of Famer.
Yo.
Yeah, that's the we say DJ Premier immediately Hall of Fame. You say Grant Hill, and you got to think a little bit.
I like it. I like it. Now, I'm going to be honest with you, Mr. Moody. I had to break rule number one of the I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast when I met with Primo. I had to fact check because I was so... When I started preparing for the interview and I started going over all the beats that he put together...
Right. Prolific.
I had to fact check because I knew that if I went in there unprepared and without a list of an agenda, a clear agenda, the podcast would get fucked up because the dude has done so...
1989.
Just the Gangstar beats. Yeah. Like, just if we just talk about the production and the craftsmanship of the Gangstar beats.
Yeah, right.
Alone.
That's a podcast.
That's a whole, just Gangstar.
Yeah.
Because one of the things about Gangstar, they didn't put out, like, you know, a record with 10 songs.
Uh-huh.
They put the shits out with, like, 18 tracks, B-sides,
yeah.
Remixes, all sorts of fly shit.
And it's all from Primo.
All from motherfucking DJ Premier. So we did a sit down. It's a full catalog, but I came in there with notes, lists, and I fact checked.
That's what's
I felt bad about it, but I knew it was in the best interest of the I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast to break rule number one of the I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast. Like I said, it's a podcast, but it's going to feel more like a motherfucking documentary.
Right.
You know who else we got? Meta World Peace, Chauncey Billups, Lamar Odom is returning during the playoffs.
He liked it that much.
Yo. we're doing all NBA playoffs with Lamar Odom.
Oh, word?
Yup.
Oh, that's what's up.
It's going to be dope. Like, we're going to watch games. We're going to break down games, go over matches.
Oh, for real?
With Lamar during the playoffs. It's I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast, okay?
Yeah.
And you can reach out to us, people. We've been getting all the emails. I see all of them, okay? We'll do an episode where we respond to you on the air, but we are responding to the emails. I Am Rapaport Podcast at gmail.com. Complaints, things you like, things you don't like, whether or not G Moody, it's April, we're in April.
I got some ill shit. I'm not going to say nothing, but you will see my progress through video, and I got the ancient Chinese secret.
To throw back time.
I got the ancient Chinese secret.
What is it?
Money, I got somebody training me, B.
Okay, let me ask you a
question. And he's Chinese, so that's why I call him the ancient Chinese secret.
Who's going to help you pull off dunking?
And he's ill.
And what have you
he
started?
He got the illest dunks. This ain't no Jeremy Lin motherfucker. This is some other shit.
Okay.
He sent me some shit where he doing some Damo type shit.
What does it have to do with you?
But he is a trainer. So he said, yo, I could get you doing this shit with no problem.
Okay.
So I'm meeting money tomorrow. So I call him my ancient Chinese secret.
Tomorrow's your first.
That's when I start. I'm on some rocky shit. You're going to see progress day by video.
Please post videos.
Of course. We get ready.
Because I am being inundated.
Yeah, I see the motherfucker.
They're hitting me left and right. Like the
they DMs, don't know me.
And they're like, oh, is he going to dunk? I said, this motherfucker ain't dunking donuts.
Watch.
He's not taking a donut into some coffee and dunking it. That's what I tell him. And I'm telling you right to your face because I want to make sure that when people DM me and they say about Moody, I say exactly what I say to you to your face because they're like, ooh, and I'm like, ooh, I'll tell him to his fucking face. What?
I got a 5'10 Chinese dude from Brooklyn training me doing windmills. How the fuck he do it?
You've never done a windmill.
I don't want to do it. All I got to do is get up off two, boom, and flush it. Easy. Easy. The ancient Chinese secret, B.
Viceland, for some strange reason, they went to go meet the engineers that are behind the most hyper-realistic sex robots being built in the world. And I like Vice. I like Viceland. But the question I have for the people that put because a producer said, let's do a story on this. Why? Why do you want to...
He's a freak.
why do you want to do an article about this?
He's a freak.
Do you want to fuck one of the dolls?
Yeah, you want to try to mask it as, oh, we're doing documentary studies. No, you want to buy one. So you can put
it in... You want a discount or some shit, dude?
Yeah. And what happened?
It's the same thing. Like, one of the market is called Slut Ever. That's... I didn't say it. Slut Ever.
That's one of the dolls?
That's
lines?
What they call the...
freaks, man.
Yo...
You just want something.
I'm my worst, most loneliest old man diaper. I'm in a hospital alone, shitting all over myself. I'm not having sex with a robot.
With a mechanical. After some shit like that, you should just die. Like, yo, that's it.
You freak off?
Yeah, with a mechanical thing that they made up.
We've been documenting this for a long time
for
now.
Years.
Yo, this is going to happen. Yo, by the time in 20 years, this is going to be common. Motherfuckers are going to be walking down the street diddy bopping with robot chicks.
Yeah, at Starbucks.
Nah, I'm not doing that.
With pre-recorded shit.
Nah, I'm not doing all that.
The woman talks to you in pre-recorded shit.
Nah, we're not doing all that.
Yo, motherfuckers ain't going to be fucking with regular women anymore. After a while... Because you know you're not gonna get no beef from no robot.
Yo.
You could come in late, 6 a.m.
And you're gonna be like, hey, honey, the one he's calling honey's gonna be like, oh, hi, sweetie.
Yeah.
And you feel good about yourself? You're like, you think cause the robot's not questioning what you do, you feel good? You think that's dope? You think that's crunk? That's not fly.
That's actually more lonely. That's loneliness.
You're talking to a robot, Duke. You're talking to like a fucking iPhone. Like an iPod and shit. You're talking to the radio.
And people have been seeing dudes on cruises. They got their dolls. They sitting in restaurants with their dolls now. They gave it up. They said, fuck it. She's like, hey.
All right, Miles, Jordan, please cue the sick fuck of the week music.
This award is earned, not given. It's called the sick fuck of the week. This guy's really sick. Lock him up.
How could you do it?
Don't let him out.
Damn. Who fucked the dog?
You what?
Who fucked the dog?
Why would he fuck the dog? Why would you fuck your girlfriend's dog?
What sick fuck?
The sick fuck of the week. It's earned.
Earned.
Not given. You did what? No.
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 It's the sick fuck of the week music. This is an award that is earned, not given. It is an award that is earned. Huh. Oh, yeah. It's not given. Okay. First up on this week's sick fuck of the week award, it's going out to Christina Maddox, 33 years old, making threats on Facebook to blow up, and I quote, everything at a Florida elementary school during a teacher planning day. You think that's funny?
Yeah, in this climate, damn.
I think that this Christina Maddox, who, by the way, if you look her up, she looks like a sick fuck. She should actually bring out the gimp. We should gimp her and bring her out leashed up, cuffed up, shackled up, bring out the gimp.
Yeah.
Because who in this day and age would think to say something like that, that would threaten to blow up everything at an elementary school? Christina Maddox, congratulations. Congratulations. You are one of many, many, many sick fucks of the week. A four-year-old school administrator in Jersey, straight out of Jersey,
New Jersey,
was arrested for threatening four-year-olds, specifically one four-year-old who was acting up. Now, this could have been me. This whole disruptive behavior lifestyle, this started when I was young.
Right.
I was kicked out of preschool. Kicked out of the third grade of public school.
So you could see yourself being threatened.
This could have been me.
Right.
Let's just say this four-year-old, I don't even know if this is true, but let's just say this four-year-old was a real pain in the ass. A disruptive force like myself. Does he deserve to be threatened by some old crazy lady? I can't even pronounce her fucking name. With a knife? Imagine you hear that your son was threatened by a school administrator with a knife. You can't control. Lock this animal up.
Yeah, no doubt. Yo, I got one. I got an ill one.
I'm going to pass you the ball. I'm not going to Russell Westbrook the sick fuck of the week.
Yeah, we're a team.
Yeah.
All right. I call this guy a triple crown sick fuck. A sexual deviant and a no good judge. Robert Cisale, whatever his fucking name is, that we don't pronounce it when you wild out.
Yeah, we don't go out of our way.
Yeah. Robert Cisale.
I think it's Cicale.
Cicale breaks into his neighbor's house and steals her soiled underwear.
And this is a judge. I actually heard about this sick fuck. And you know where he's from? Long Island.
Yes.
But before you go further in breaking this down, I wanted to say that. And I'm not proud of this because my mother is from Long Island.
Yeah.
I am Rapaport Stereo Podcast guest who's been kicking ass. Our guy Danny Green is from Strong Island. Lyle Alzado's from Long Island.
Yeah.
Howard Stern is from Long Island.
Of course.
Eddie Murphy is from Long Island.
Public Enemy.
Great Dr. J is from Long Island.
Yeah.
But I will say this. In 2018, there has been quite a lot of sick fucks from, of course, Florida. But Long Island is definitely in the house.
Yes, creeping up. I just say that is self-explanatory. What do you want to do with this woman's soiled underwear.
And how did you become a judge, you sick fuck you?
And what is the parameters for being disbarred?
Oh, no, this is a sicko.
Yeah.
This is a sick fuck. He not only had his neighbor's panties, he had pockets full of other people's underwear when they busted him.
And this is a judge rendering decisions on people's lives.
This is a sick fuck. Maybe rendering decisions on people's lives.
Maybe we should look at some of those cases.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? Let some of these people out.
Abso-fucking-lutely.
This guy's judging you? Get the fuck out of here.
Hell no.
Fuck out of here.
Hell no. And I want to say this, yo, I would never recommend another podcast unless it was dope. And this is a one of these serial-driven podcasts. It's like a story thing. It's like a 60-minute type of thing. I listened to this podcast. My wife hit me to it. Really fucking good. Check this podcast out called Empire on Blood.
Okay.
Empire on Blood. It's one of these cases of a guy who was a notorious drug dealer. He's very open about, you know, his past as a drug dealer up in the Bronx.
Okay.
On, I think, 213th Street, which I guess in the 90s was a really fucked up, you know, they used to call it, you know, Empire on Blood, like this corner. And this kid was, you know, involved in all kind of shit. Like all kinds of crime. He's very open about it, but he got convicted of a double murder. And the podcast and this journalist who's bugged out, it's very entertaining, very compelling, you know, sort of follows him, and he's been doing it for a long time, and he breaks down to 7-part podcast. You know, it's like one of these ones, you know, it has a beginning, middle, and end. Empire on Blood. Check it out. If you like true crime stories, I want to give a shout out to these guys. It's well done. I actually want to talk to the guy who did it because he's a bug out. He's a New York dude. So if you like other podcasts, if you like, you know, true crime shit, check out Empire on Blood. And I'm just doing that just because I saw it just for the strength.
Okay.
Because like a lot of people get caught up with sick, no good judges in this podcast.
Oh, of course.
I wanted to let you decide, Mr. Moody.
Okay.
Who you thought the sick fuck of the week was on this one. At a restaurant in Toronto that serves, it's called Antler. Okay, so obviously they serve meat, they serve deer. Mm. You know, one of their specialties is freshly killed deer, you know, cooked and all that stuff. It's a restaurant in Toronto called Antler.
I had deer in South Carolina.
Recently?
No, when I was down there with my cousins. Shit is good.
Okay, so... And I've been vegan. Not vegan. Vegetarian.
You rocking it.
I've been doing it.
I'll hear you.
You see, I look good.
I wouldn't say that, motherfucker. Yeah,
fuck you.
Go ahead.
All right, so, but one thing about vegetarians and vegans that no one likes, no one wants to hear about it.
Yeah, because y'all motherfuckers be just ramming it down motherfuckers' throat.
You make a motherfucker want to eat like a pork loin right in front of you. And that's probably what happened with this guy. So there was protesters outside this restaurant, which is a legitimate restaurant, a popular restaurant. And one of the chefs came to the front of the window with the deer, started preparing it, cutting it up.
Oh.
Right in front of the protesters, like, yo, you're going to protest my restaurant? Fuck you.
Oh, I like money.
So do you think he's a sick fuck?
No.
Okay.
He's a chef, B. He's a chef. You are wrong for being outside of his restaurant. He's a chef, so he got to disembowel. He got to fucking cut shit and get the chops and all that. That's his job. Is it your job to be there on some social justice? No, animal justice bullshit? Get the fuck away from my man's restaurant, B.
That's why I asked you. That's why I asked you. We're rocking and rolling. I told you we had a whole bunch of sick fucks. A former Ohio teacher pled guilty to charges stemming from giving birth to her student turned foster son's baby.
Oh, she adopted?
She adopted?
Just a skeet.
A kid, and then gave birth
to
the baby. You sick fuck.
Yeah, that's bugged out. But what about...
How sick do you have to be? Think about that.
She's like, I'm going to take this motherfucker home with
me. I'm going to take him home. I'm going to adopt him. And then I'm going to have a fucking baby with, like...
And she's married.
nut job.
Yo, as a guy, what do you tell cats at the bar?
Like, yo, we broke up. Why?
Fucking with an 11-year-old.
This is insane. This is a sick fuck. Laura Lynn Cross. Have you ever seen Laura Lynn Cross?
No.
If you look at her, you have any idea what she looks like?
Of course.
A sick fuck.
But, yo, this shit is bugged out. I would have loved, if I'm 14 and they going at me like that, I know I would have loved it, son. I got to be honest.
But you wouldn't have been able to, you wouldn't have, like, who knows?
Maybe I would have lived with
when
this
you're,
chick.
When you're 14, who knows? You might have skied it.
I would have. You might have puppy water. You don't know yet.
Marinda Polston in Kentucky. A woman from Kentucky, Marinda Polston, was arrested, charged with abuse in an incident after she caught her daughter drinking alcohol to punish her. You know what she did? She forced her to drink more alcohol to the point of extreme intoxication and alcohol poisoning.
Oh.
So the daughter was doing something wrong by drinking alcohol. So to prove her point, she made her drink more, almost killed the daughter. You think this is good parenting, you sick fuck?
Yeah.
Marinda Polston?
Yeah, come
You're
on.
You're a 14-year-old? That's the only way you thought that to solve the problem? To teach your daughter the lesson?
People experiment, man. You almost killed that girl.
A mother of a kid who was suffering from autism was so overwhelmed from dealing with the child, she tried to decapitate him with a bow saw. The mother of an autistic kid, she was so overwhelmed.
Yeah, it's a motherfucker.
By dealing with the boy's sickness, with his autism, she feared he would be a burden on society, tried to decapitate her 11-year-old son with a fucking bow saw. These are people out here.
Yeah.
These are wild. People next to you in line at the fucking when you're getting a cheeseburger.
Word. At CVS, they right behind you.
Finally, right here in New York City, a man, young guy, good-looking guy, walking to get on the subway. Out of nowhere, a woman runs up to him, pushes him into the tracks. Luckily, he was able to move out of the way, didn't get fucking killed by the train. Of course, this sick fuck, Marjorie Chambers, 57 years old, is a 27-year-old strapping construction worker.
Yeah, you never stand by you stand in front of the pillar. So if you try to push me, you got to push the whole station down.
Yeah, I stand with my back to the wall.
Yeah.
I've always been scared of that shit. When that train is coming, I always look behind me, look to the side of me, uh-huh. Every single time. I'm never at the end of that shit.
Yeah, I always in front of that pillar or back to the wall.
Fortunately, Stephen Ware of Queens is in the house. He survived and he's fine. But you in Union Square, one of the busiest train stations in the entire world.
Yeah.
And you're just trying to get on your train after a long day's work. Lady just comes up to you. He didn't know her. Didn't know nothing about her. Pushed him into the track. This motherfucker could have died. Fortunately, he saved. This is a jam-packed segment of the award-winning Sick Fucks of the Week.
Yep.
All right, G. Moody, what can I say? It's a very, very jam-packed I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast. Want to give shout-outs.
Oh, shout-out to LL Cool J, starting Rock the Bells Radio on Sirius. Radio XM.
Yup.
Sirius XM
Rock
Radio.
Rock the Bells.
So, somebody curated a place where all of our shit can be heard because it's never played anywhere else.
Nope.
And this is the foundation of the music that people love. So, these are the people who made it. LL, good job.
Yeah.
And we'll be tuning in all the time so you can hear all the good funk.
Absolutely.
And the rhyming. You can hear the rhyming.
And they're going to have all the DJs mixing, scratching, cutting.
Right.
And hopefully inspire other young DJs to mix, scratch, and cut. I can't wait to to hear the when that station officially launches. They did the soft launch. What can I say? See, I am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. My name is Michael Rapaport, a.k.a. the Jeff Ruland of podcasting, a.k.a. the Bill Ambier of podcasting.
I like that. I want to be, I'm G. Moody, the Bernhard Getz of podcasting.
What do you mean by that?
Like, I don't take no shit.
Yeah, you'll pull out the gun
on the
train.
I'll pull out the gun and try to front on us.
It's the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast, and, you know, we'll be back with more bangers coming up next.
Hello?
Torrey Smith, it's Michael Rapaport.
What's going on?
How you doing, my man?
I'm all right, chilling, man. Can't complain.
All right, well, I appreciate you coming on the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. I'm a big fan, been a big fan, and, you know, I got to tell you congratulations. Congratulations, man.
Thank you. Appreciate it, man.
How's the high been and the excitement and just, like, you know, the hysteria of being a Super Bowl champ for the second time in your career? Like, have you paid for a meal in Philadelphia since you guys won the championship?
Yeah, not gonna lie, there's definitely been a few free meals in there the past couple of weeks, but it's a lot of travel, all the things that kind of come with it, doing the media circuits. Things are finally starting to slow down now.
Well, that's good, man. That's good. What are you gonna do with the rest of your offseason, and when do you start thinking about football again?
Yeah, well, for me, I actually started working out.
Jesus.
2018 season starts for me now. I'm starting to, you know, get back into it a little bit and really just grind, start to grind, work your way up, because it's definitely a long season, so you don't want to go into overkill, but do that and focus on my charity work, which is what I do in off season.
Okay, I want to talk to you about that. So if you just started working out the other day, and obviously we're months away, what is the sort of workout that you do to sort of maintain to get, you know, preseason ready?
Yeah, you kind of, being that our season, the season's long. I don't think people realize how long it is. It definitely wears you out. And, I mean, you have 4 preseason games, 16 regular season games, and then we were lucky we had a bye. But when you look at that, you know, it's 23 games for us. The Patriots had the bye as well, so it was the same for them. But you want to get back into your routine. You don't kill yourself, you know. So for me, I'm running. Mm-hmm. I might do a little more basketball. I'm definitely lifting, but just not as heavy. It's not as pounding. But as the weeks go on, you pick it up and get back into your same old routine.
How long does it take you this season? Because I'm sure every season is different. After, you know, a long season, a long run in the playoffs, and obviously the Super Bowl, how long does it take your body to sort of just, you know, get back into neutral? I'm sure you never are without any kinks or a sore finger or a toe or something, but like, how long does it take for you to sort of like heal?
Yeah, it takes a while. And honestly, I've learned the older that I've gotten, moving as a part of that. The longer you sit still, mm-hmm. I feel like you stiffen up a little bit, in my opinion. It's kind of like a car that sits. It's harder to start it back up, but you need to rest at the same time. So there's a fine line. I've definitely rested a lot over the past couple of weeks besides the traveling. And lack of sleep, my body hasn't been taking really a pounding. But, you know, I think what my plan for the next few weeks in terms of yoga, running, playing some ball, staying fluid, I think that's going to be huge for me to get back in it.
All right, well, that's cool. I'm a yoga guy myself, and I'm sure you're probably faster than me, stronger than me. Obviously, you could catch a football better than me. But I guarantee you, Torrey Smith, 2-time Super Bowl champion, and I'll say this to your face, and I'll prove it when I see you, I'm far more flexible than you. I'm the superior stretcher than you. I know you'd be shocked. I'm malleable. I'm like a 6-month-old baby. Okay, like I'm malleable.
I'm not surprised, man. I'll tell you what, and I'm the complete opposite, so I guarantee you have me whooped on that front.
So I'm sure you've been asked this, and I'm sure you got a politically correct question. Going into next season, and you already know where I'm going with this, Nick Foles kicked ass. You know, he came in there. I mean, you know, I'm sure you were like, it's all done. It's going downhill after Carson Wentz, who was kicking ass. I mean, you had 2 quarterbacks who kicked ass on top of kicking ass. How do you think this is going to be? Forget your opinion. And I know it's hard to answer, and I definitely don't want to put you on the spot or make you feel uncomfortable. How do you think this is going to be sorted out? And have you ever even imagined or heard of something this close where you have a guy who is most likely going to win the regular season MVP, he gets replaced with a guy who winds up winning the Super Bowl MVP? Like, what do you make of this situation?
I mean, obviously Carson's hurt, but I think if they're both healthy, they're going to go with Carson. He was the MVP. You know, but it's a good problem to have when you have two MVP caliber QBs, and we wouldn't have been where we were if it wasn't for both of them. But like I said, I think it's a good problem to have, and it gives the team some time to make sure that Carson's back 100%.
What kind of a leader was Carson Wentz, and compare him to Nick Foles?
Well, I think the two of them are two of the better leaders I've been around, period, at any position. They both lead by example. Both guys you want to play with and play for. And more bigger than that, they're just really good men. And I think that, you know, that I've never seen a quarterback room that tight.
Okay.
Which is often is, I mean, I've been around quarterbacks that everyone gets along, but it was a little different to me to see them. They were both, all three of them, all very strong in their faith, challenged each other. And like Carson was genuinely happy for him, even, and that's right. Probably one of the toughest moments of his life. But, you know, he was genuinely happy for him, and that's how they are. It's just as men.
Staying on the quarterbacks, obviously you won the Super Bowl with the Ravens, with Joey Flacco. What was he like as a quarterback? And, you know, this is a few years ago. Some might say that was his prime. He's still kicking ass. You know, he has to deal with injuries. What was he like as a quarterback during your run with him?
Joe's a beast. He still is a beast. I don't care what anyone says.
I agree.
You know, he's a great quarterback, and you know, that's my guy. Stand up for him any day of the week. And you know, I know that he's gonna bounce back. He's healthy. They protect him. You know, he's gonna do his job.
That Super Bowl, obviously, there. You know, when you look back on it, the Ray Lewis, the Kaepernick, and that game was the game at halftime where the power went out in the building. What do you remember about that situation with the power going out? And like, what was going on with your team? Like, and did you think like, yo, this game could possibly be canceled?
Nah, honestly, I thought it was like a conspiracy because we just ran that kickback at the halftime. I'm like, oh man, we gonna blow these boys out. And then the power goes out, and they came out ready to ball, and we didn't. And it was a heck of a game. It was crazy. You know, I'm looking around, like, everyone's stiffening up, trying to stay loose, but you really don't know when the power is going to come back on. And those lights don't just pop on. Like, it's not like your kitchen light or something where you change it and it's right back on. Like, no, like, it takes time for the lights to even warm back up. So that was a weird time, but I'm just glad ultimately that we ended up finishing the game.
Were you guys really saying, yo, this is some bullshit? Like, yo, this, they're trying to slow down the momentum? Like, was that really something that was being discussed while you were, like, over there stretching and everything?
Absolutely. I think everyone has that in them. You always think it's a conspiracy when things aren't going your way or when something weird happens.
That, to me, I loved Kaepernick's run that season. And where do you think in 10, 15 years, what do you think the impact of Colin Kaepernick will be on the NFL?
I think he'll be mentioned his impact is way bigger than the NFL. I think he'll be mentioned with some of the greatest leaders ever. In terms of folks who took a stance, especially as athletes, you can't take that away from them. There's been things and conversations that have advanced so far because he took a knee. Mm-hmm. People have been fighting. People out here literally dedicate their lives to this. And they were kind of at a stumbling block, and then Cap takes a knee, and things are starting to roll in the right direction. And people are more aware and want to learn more about what's going on and what's wrong in our country, and honestly learn how to articulate it. And so because he just decided to take a knee, he's going to help make this country to really be a better place.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. And, you know, I know you had a lot of outspoken guys on your team, and I just respect it because people, you know, we could sit here on the sidelines saying, you guys should do this, you guys should do that. And you know, as they proved with Kaepernick, you know, there's consequences.
I mean, I'm saying just for us in general, like, it's selfish as an athlete to walk away from a problem when you know it affects you, when you're not on the field. but it affects your family each and every day. I think it's just your responsibility as a man. It goes beyond the field, and it affects our fans if you want to talk about the people who are spending dollars. So I think it'll be something that people have always spoken up. People have always said their opinions, but now people are listening to what athletes are saying, and social media kind of helps with that in terms of using your platform and lending your voice.
Yeah, I agree. Now, I'm going to keep it funky with you, Torrey. I'm a New York Giants fan. I was in a conundrum. You know, the day of the Super Bowl, I vowed to become a Philadelphia Eagles fan for the day, because as much as I cannot stand the Eagles, I do love the city of Philadelphia, and as much as I can't stand the Eagles, I disdain the New England Patriots. So how good does it feel? Keep it real with me. To knock the fucking Patriots, Tom Brady, and to just dismantle Matty Patricia's defense and his pencil and his beard. I mean, he shaved after you guys beat him. You guys made that guy take a shower and a shave. He's never shaves. He never takes a shower. You guys dismantled the Patriots. How good does that feel? Keep it funky with me.
I mean, it feels good to win, period. You know, whoever that is. And, you know, if you know my history, I played in Baltimore, so we had to go through New England to get to where we want to be in terms of winning the Super Bowl. And the first year they got us, they lost to the Giants in the Super Bowl.
Yes, I remember that.
My second year we got them. So that's a great rivalry. And one thing that stands out about it is that, you know, it's always good to be the best. You got to beat the best. Mm. And that's who, you know, that's who they've been consistently for a while.
What was the sort of mentality going into that game, like, that you saw the vulnerability? Because you tore them up.
Yeah, it was just to be ourselves. You know, when you go into it, we feel comfortable standing against any defense. You know, we've been one of the best offenses all year, and that didn't change. We're always confident in ourselves, just ran our offense, and we knew we could make plays. So that's no disrespect to anybody on the other side, but, you know, there's never a game that we went into feeling like, you know, we weren't going to win our matchups.
And what do you make of the Malcolm Butler benching? And it would have swayed the game. It would have changed the game. What is your take on that?
To me, he's just going to be the other person that's going to have to get this work. You know, that's how we approached it. You know, they have some very talented corners over there. And obviously, I mean, shoot, they wouldn't even have won one of their Super Bowls if it wasn't for him. So, you know, they're very talented. But it was a surprise. You know, we didn't know that. We didn't expect it. I don't know why they did it. That's really none of my business. But we just knew that we studied them, and he was the major piece. And I don't know. I don't think anyone knows what happened.
So you would say that he is the best DB on that team, right? I mean, like, that's obvious, correct?
I wouldn't necessarily say that. You know, I think they have, you know, all the talents. They're all different.
Right.
So, I mean, I think that's the coach's decision.
Through your career, you've played against so many defensive backs and safeties and linebackers. Throughout your career, who would you say are some of the defenders that are the biggest talkers?
Ike Taylor. He always got the best of me. He had me talking every game.
And what about Ray Lewis when you were practicing with him? What made Ray Lewis so special? Like, obviously, you're on the offensive squad. What made Ray Lewis Ray Lewis?
I think it was his work ethic, his commitment. You don't play that long if you're not dedicated and grind the way you do. So you would see that in practice when he was out there. Obviously, the type of leader he was, that kind of spoke for himself. But just his work ethic and, you know, his attention to detail and everything, just to be great.
What is the first memory that when you made it into the NFL where you were like, holy crap, I'm out here. Like, I've worked all this time, high school, college, and now I'm actually on the field. Like, what was that surreal, I'm actually with these dudes moment, and who was it against?
Actually, my first start in the NFL. I had a rough training camp. I came in during a lockout, so we didn't have any practice in the summertime. We had no practice, and I was struggling in camp. And the first couple of games, you know, I was a third receiver. I never had the ball thrown to me. And then all of a sudden, Lee Evans gets hurt, and I had to start. And the first play of the game, first play of offense, I scored like a 75-yard touchdown. First catch, touchdown. And then they come back to me a few more times. And my first three catches were touchdowns. So that was something that's pretty cool to be able to share with the kids. It was an NFL record.
Are, at that point, are you like, yo, what's all the fuss about? Like, this is easy work? Like, the NFL? Like, this is a joke?
You know, it just gives you confidence. I think that's huge. I think a major piece of success in general is just being confident in yourself. And so there were times where I struggled with that in camp, trying to learn and just all, kind of all over the place. But when you go out there and you have success, it's like, man, that's who I am. And the key to when you get older is like, you know who you are, regardless of what's going on, what your struggles may be, that you know how to grind and how to right the ship.
Right. When you have a week off, who are your favorite receivers to watch in the NFL now? Like, who would be like your top four or five guys that you're just a fan of that impress you, that you're like, yo, I'm chilling this weekend, or there's a Monday night game, I have to watch who?
Yeah, I like watching Antonio Brown. Like watching Julio Jones, Odell, Beckham, Nuke Hopkins. Uh-huh. There's a lot of talented guys. I like watching Thielen and Diggs up in Minnesota. Diggs and Terp.
Yeah, they're good.
You know, it's a lot of young guys that, you know, that in this league that I enjoy watching. You every week you watch someone and you just kind of admire their talent, their abilities, because I mean, this game isn't easy. And sometimes, dude, do some things. You're like, man, that's God-given ability.
Yeah, I agree. You said you're playing ball in the off season. What's your crew? You're from Virginia. Are you a Wizards fan? Like, what's your team? And you know, like I always say, like you're one of these two guard receivers, big, athletic, you know, fast. You know, like a Dwayne Wade in his prime. What kind of game do you got? And what's your favorite NBA team?
That's kind of like how I play, you know, especially when I'm on. Just got to slash a little bit. I spot up and shoot.
Can you bang it on somebody?
Too much now. Absolutely.
Ooh.
But, you know, I just try to go out there and just really try to be more conscious. Now, when I was younger, I'd be rolling. I'd be trying to dog everyone and be all aggressive. Now it's like, man, it's more important to get the cardio in. And, you know, I'll still dunk on somebody, but, you know, try to be smart because you have to make it to the next day.
And what's your favorite team, Torrey?
I would kind of say it depends on where I am. Like, I'm more of a fan of players.
Okay.
You know, so I can appreciate different teams. Like, and obviously, you know, being around, you know, certain guys. But like, I like watching the Wizards. I've been to a bunch of their games. I've seen John Wall, Bradley Beal. I was in San Fran, so you know, it's easy to watch Steph, KD, and all them cats. And, you know, KD's a guy who, you know, I've known since college. He's come up on our campus. Back when he's too young to even make it to the clubs, being in the league. So
when you were in college, he would come around?
Yeah, and I was in college. I think it might be actually the same school year.
Now, at that point, was he like 140 pounds?
Yeah, maybe, you know, he's still a, you know, same old KD. But, you know, we all remember seeing him on campus. Like, man, why didn't he come here? He'd have been a beast at Maryland, but he went to Texas and did his thing.
Now, listen, this isn't a football question I'm going to ask you. So, I want you to keep it funky with me, man. Who in the NFL has game, and who in the NFL is trash but thinks they have game in basketball? Keep it real with me. Come on, man. Give me something.
Some guys that can hoop. You know what? I've been hearing lately that Le'Veon Bell can really hoop.
Who ain't shit, Torrey? Whose ass, what NFL player, former or current, have you bust their ass in basketball? Keep it real with me.
I can't think of anybody. I mean, I've been to enough charity games to know that some guys are like really trash. Like, I remember Damian Barry. Like, he's one of the worst players I've ever seen in my life.
So you're on the record saying Damian Barry's trash. He's trash.
He's trash. But everywhere you go, you're going to see somebody that's, you know, that's really, really good, and someone that's just horrible.
Just give me one more name of somebody like, yo, my man, don't embarrass yourself. You're a great football player, but you shouldn't be out here. Give it to me.
I'm over here trying to think of who's kind of my game. Like, even Joe Flacco was like, he had one year where he was horrible. But otherwise that, like, Joe's a very athletic. He can shoot.
Right.
He can play ball. He was wearing these little Daisy Duke shorts one year. That's why he played so bad. But, you know, but I can't even say he fits in that. He just had one bad game because he's very athletic.
All right, listen, Torrey, I appreciate you coming on the podcast. Congratulations on winning your second Super Bowl. Congratulations to the Philadelphia Eagles. Congratulations and continue to do all the charity work. And fantastic luck going into next season. And I'll talk to you soon, my man.
Thank you. Appreciate it, man.
Absolutely, Torrey. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy the weekend.
All right. Peace.
Geno, go get your shine box, Geno. Let me start by saying I love women's basketball. I don't have a problem with women's basketball at all. Fuck it. I've even played women's basketball. I get right in, and I don't shy away from the competition. I have actually had my ass busted by women playing basketball. So let's get that straight right out of the gate. I've played in celebrity games with Sue Bird, Skylar Diggins, and Lisa Leslie, and a bunch of others, and I know where I stand. I have the utmost respect for women that play ball, and I have mad respect for the University of Connecticut's fantastic women's basketball team. But they are straight demolishing teams. Now again, I don't have a problem with the young, talented women on that team. But I have a real problem with the coach. Yeah, I got a real fucking problem. That's right, Geno Arena, Auriemma, Orientic, Obama, however the fuck you say your last name. I got a problem, and I think a few others may as well, but they're too damn scared to talk about it. Well, guess who's not scared? Michael Rapaport. Me, the Gringo Mandingo, a.k.a. Milk, a.k.a. White Mike. That's right, Geno. This shit is out of balance. You won 100 games in a row, and 56 of them, you won by 40 points or more. Geno, when is enough enough? You're looking like a fucking girl bully out there. How about I go out there and get some real girl bully goons from Brownsville, Brooklyn? How about I get some girls that eat fucking hoop dreams for breakfast, huh? How about I drive a bus around and I collect a gang of girl bullies to bully your team? Or maybe they just do a little shove job on you personally, Geno. Would that be fun for you? What I really want to know is why the hell haven't you moved on? You have conquered women's college hoops. Now get on with it. Grab your balls and coach somewhere else, anywhere else. Let's go. It's time to step it up. When will you finally look around the arena and think, maybe it's time to take my talents elsewhere? I've done everything I can in this league. I've shit on every program in our division and around the country. And I think maybe I need a real challenge in my life. Maybe, just maybe, it's time to play with the big girls in the WNBA. Or just maybe it's time to play with some men. You ever think about that, Geno? You want to go down as one of the best coaches of all time? Your record might get you a meeting, but you don't get a seat at the table. No, sorry. You don't get to sit with the Vince Lombardis, the Bobby Knights, Phil Jacksons, Greg Popovich, or Bill Belichick's. And if you see the ghost of John Wooden, get him some goddamn water because the man's soul is thirsty from years and years of hard-fought competition and constantly challenging himself. You're embarrassing teams, Geno, and that's not what the game is all about. That's not what sports is all about. That's not what life is all about. You don't get a seat at the big boy table, Auriemma. You walk into that room and you try to take a seat, it's going to feel like a scene straight out of Goodfellas. And you ain't Joe Pesci, my friend. You're Spider. Yeah. Remember Spider? He was the kid Joe Pesci's character shot in the foot for not getting his drink order right. Let me spell it out for you. I know a thing or two about scenes.
Interior, back room, Italian restaurant, night. Geno Auriemma walks in. Others take notice. Around the table sit the great coaches of the past and present. Bobby Knight, Vince Lombardi, Phil Jackson, Greg Popovich, Bill Belichick, and John Wooden. Geno takes a seat. The others look on with disdain, stunned even.
Hey, fellas, look, it's Geno Amorosa. Hey, what's the good word, Geno? What team did you finish embarrassing this week? Hey, guys, we just beat Central Florida by 55, and tonight we beat Tulsa by 60. Shit, I'm exhausted from all the ass-kicking. We got any beers, fellas?
As a matter of fact, we do. Why don't you go ahead to the fridge and fetch me and Lombardi a couple of cold ones?
Oh, you're funny.
I'm funny? How the fuck am I funny, huh? The fuck is so funny about me? Funny? Like what? Like a clown? Do I amuse you, Eugene?
No, I was just saying you're funny. I mean, you tell me to get beers and all, and I'm blowing out teams left and right, and, you know, I just...
You're blowing out girls, is that right, Geno?
Yeah, Vince.
It's Mr. Lombardi.
Sorry. Sorry about that, Mr. Lombardi.
You ever think about maybe coaching men, Auriemma?
Nah, I mean, got a good thing going, you know. It's Auriemma.
You think you got a good thing going, huh? I split wins with Purdue in 87 in what we call a goddamn rivalry, and then went on to win the title that year. No blowouts. We fought hard. I caught a stress hernia in 87. I haven't been the same since.
Popovich slams his hand down hard on the table. Geno goes wide-eyed, scared of what might come next.
You're on easy street, Geno. I've seen the frickin' Lakers 7 times in the playoffs in my life. You know what that feels like, huh? You know what the fuck that feels like? Not knowing what the hell is going to happen in the game? You don't think challenging yourself makes any sense?
No, I mean, you know, we're really killing these teams, and I like the feeling of it. And, you know, we did just lose for the first time also to Mississippi State during the tournament game.
Thank fucking goodness.
Well, I was trying to tell you guys.
You trying to impress us with all that killing you're doing, Geno, huh? You're a killer. You're a killer. I'm so fucking impressed. I can't believe what a fucking killer you are.
My shoulder's got a fucking knot. Come rub it out, will you, Geno? I got a knot from sitting too long, doing meditation, thinking about the Jordan rules that the goddamn Detroit Pistons implemented when they took my title in 1989. Who's got the Epsom salts?
Try to relax, Phil. Geno, you heard him. He's got a meditation knot. And now get at it.
Well, I don't think I really,
Rub the fucking muscle, Geno. Now, shit, now look what the fuck happened over here.
Belichick spills hot sauce on his ripped hoodie. No one moves. Not a peep. Night pipes in.
Well, now this. The man spilled on his favorite sweatshirt and Phil's all knotted out. Bust through the knot, Geno, will ya? You do massage, don't you, Geno?
No, I don't really do massages.
Oh, no, you don't do massages. You blow out women's basketball teams by 50. That's what you do, right? You win 100 games in a row, and no one comes close to beating you, and you're happy about that.
He's fucking happy about that. Lifetime, I'm 105-35-6, fuckface. I know what it is to lose. Not much, but I know. It made me strong. Excuse me.
Bobby Knight gets up from the table and hurls a metal chair against the wall.
See what the fuck I do now.
A man's angry.
Well, I mean, get my sweatshirt, Geno. You're embarrassing me. You never had to make a comeback. You ever watch the Super Bowl, Geno? It's a big game played by big men.
Come on, coach. Of course I have.
Grab my hoodie before you give Phil a rub down.
Come on, guys. I was just trying to sit down and then have a drink, talk shop.
Roll me a joint and rub my toe, too. Shit hurts.
Guys.
Don't guys us. Step up your level of competition, Geno. You're not earning. Put a Purdue in your life. Put a Kentucky in your world. A team that challenges you game after game, season after season. Earn it.
Man needs to fucking earn, Geno.
You disgust me right now, Eugene.
Be a man, Geno.
Step it up.
You're such a winner, huh? Huh? Well, it's time to take your fucking talents elsewhere, Auriemmano.
It's Auriemma.
Who cares
what it is.
But fellas, I thought we were all friends.
Well, you thought wrong, fucknose. Leave the women alone, Geno.
It's embarrassing for all of us.
The streets are talking.
All right, I'll work on it. Well, why are you guys breaking my balls?
Geno, if I was breaking your balls, I'd tell you to go get your fucking shine box.
One by one, the coaches slowly get up from the table, leaving Geno to contemplate his future alone. Geno hangs his head while Lombardi's soul dissipates into thin air. Phil gets up with a cane. Bobby Knight mumbles something under his breath about the Republican Party and hurries out. Popovich takes a last swig of his beer and heads for the door. And Belichick keeps scrubbing the stain from his weathered hoodie.
You made it through that scene the same way you've made it through every one of your seasons, Geno. Unscathed. But unscathed is no way to go through life, my man. If you expect your players to step up to the challenges they face every day on and off the court, then maybe you need to challenge yourself in another endeavor, Geno. And if that's not something you're willing to do, then seriously, go get your shine box. I'm kidding, Geno. I'm kidding. But take a leap of faith. The worst that could happen is you might win a few games by 2 points and not 50. Or maybe your team goes on a 4-game losing streak. It happens to the best of them. Bouncing back? It's part of the process. And it doesn't feel as bad as you might think, Geno.
All right, we're done. We're done. Yo, if you want to keep coming at me at the root, keep coming at me. I told you, 15 rounds rough, rugged, and raw. Yes, I do it hardcore. I want to thank our guest, Torrey Smith of the Carolina Panthers, Super Bowl champion with the Philadelphia Eagles. Thanks for rocking with us. On the Iron Rapaport Stereo Podcast, G Moody, whose last name rhymes with duty. We're going to be back in primetime podcast, and coming up later on this week with Meta World Peace. I did the premiere episode, like we talked about earlier. So many bangers, so many hits, so much Smash Mouth podcasts, and it's the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. Torrey Smith, thank you for rocking with the best. Congratulations on the Super Bowl. Congratulations on greener pastures with Cam Newton and the Carolina Panthers. It's the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. I'm out.